Folks, we are back live. It's T2sday update time. I'm going to keep the live stream going for an hour today, and I think in general it's going to be the T2sday update hour. Hopefully the presentation will only be 20 minutes or 25 minutes, whatever it happens to be, but I will hang around if people want to chat or if they show up late, whatever it is, we can make time. We'll make like an actual sort of a regular talk, and if nobody's around, I'll just work on getting ready to the video ready to upload or whatever. I've got a ton of stuff to talk about today. It's going to take a while. It all started when Ben Krulis came into the T2 chat room a few days after the previous update and linked us to this video of the Tesla AI Day live stream that had very interesting stuff in it. And it led me down to this rabbit hole that, you know, number one, it turned out that as far as computer architecture goes, Intel had their annual architecture day also on Friday, August 19th, the same damn day as the Tesla AI day. And it led me to thinking about scalability and computer architecture and different approaches to it, different philosophies to it, and I want to unpack that a little bit. And so this is going to be a different kind of update because it's rather than looking into the T2 tile, it's the T2 tile project sort of looking out at the world. And it's going to take a little while. Hopefully it won't be too boring. All right, let's just go. So here it is. The idea is that, you know, we've got this indefinite scalability idea, which I'll talk about in a second. And indefinite scalability, strictly, is really hard to achieve. And even the T2 tile, you know, has some marginal issues to it when you really dig into it strictly. But even if you can't achieve strict indefinite scalability, we can ask, well, how close do you come? And that's the indefinite scalability audit that I'm going to do today for the first time. And I'm going to apply it to the Intel stuff that was reported in their architecture day, in Tesla's AI day, and let's just go. All right, a reminder about indefinite scalability, or for folks who are new, the idea is, suppose you're supposed to build a computer, and you are given power, cooling, and space, real estate, and that's it. And you're supposed to design a computer architecture, a blueprint for building a computer that can get bigger and bigger and bigger, that you can add more and more and more to it, and be able to compute with all of that stuff without ever running into some internal limit like 640K or running out of pins or something like that. That's indefinite scalability. How do you do it? You define a tile that's some fixed size, fixed mass. You cannot change the tile once you started building the machine. That's the rules of strict indefinite scalability. And you put the tiles down next to each other and you see how far you can go. And strict indefinite scalability is really hard because typically once you start putting down a ton of little things, you want to, you know, put them in a box or put something else on it. But then that box is a new layer of structure. So in order to do strict indefinite scalability, the first thing you have to do is you have to find out where is the part that actually repeats absolutely without change, without adding any extra stuff. And the repeating part, that is the tile. Even if you have littler things inside it that you want to call tiles, if you have additional stuff that breaks the symmetry, so you can't just plop them down, the tile goes up to the level of wherever that is. So even if we can't be completely strictly indefinitely scalable, we can look at any actual system or any plan system and say, how is it doing? Where is it strong in scalability? Where is it falling down? And we can use that to compare systems. So we're going to compare an Intel system with a Tesla system right now. Okay, let's start with Intel. You know, in my experience, there's kind of two kinds of engineers. You know, there's kind of smooth engineers and nerd engineers. And this is Pat Gelsinger. He's the, you know, recently new CEO of Intel, and he's a smooth engineer, you know, and so he did the intro. And, you know, I have mixed a history with Intel. You know, for the longest time, they were the 800-pound gorilla in computing, and they pretty much ruled the roost. But they have fallen on some hard times, and so and sufficiently that, you know, I'm kind of rooting for them now. I want them to make a comeback. You know, you're just in a slump, not least because they have a significant investment in New Mexico, which is where I'm broadcasting from, where I live. But basically, you know, Intel, one of the few places that can actually make these chips, you know, not just ask other people to make them, they actually build them. They, you know, the way that you make money in hardware is by making your transistors, your individual little pieces of silicon, individual pieces of electronic circuitry smaller and smaller and smaller, which allows you to put more of them in the same place and use less power and just do everything good. And so that's what drove famous Moore's Law. That's why you have smartphones that are smarter than, you know, all the computers put together in the 1950s and so on. But Intel fell behind. They were stuck at the 10 nanometer node. It's called node. Each size scale, they call it a node. And, you know, 10 nanometers is unbelievably tiny. But TSMC, the Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Corporation, was already going down to 7 nanometers, and Samsung getting ready to go to 7 nanometers and so forth. And Intel was kind of stuck. They had some internal process problems. I don't know anything about the details. But they did what Intel kind of used to do sometimes when they were the 800-pound gorilla, which is just try to change the names of everything. So they say, you know these names are just numbers. So this is a quote from the TSMC guy saying, you know, these 10 nanometers, 7 nanometers, they aren't real numbers. They're just like model numbers on cars. So Intel says, well, you know, let's introduce new node naming. And so, you know, 10 nanometers, what everyone knew they were at, and now we've got Intel 7 and so forth. And Intel 7, previously referred to as SuperFin, which we previously referred to as 10 nanometers. Intel 4, previously referred to as the artist formerly known as 7 nanometers and so forth. So, okay, they're, you know, kind of, you know, sort of misleading names, Intel 7, oh, but they're just model numbers. They're not meant to be actual sizes of technology. Well, except, what's that 20A at the end? Well, the 20A is supposed to stand for 20 angstroms, and angstroms is a measure of length. An angstrom is a tenth of a nanometer, so 20 angstroms is 2 nanometers, which is indeed what makes sense. It would come after the Intel 3, if Intel 3 was a length. They're trying to have it both ways. Yeah, okay, whatever. But so on a week and a half ago now, Friday, on Intel Architecture Day, they presented a ton of new stuff, and I'm only going to, you know, dip into a little teeny bit of it. It's what appropriate for my purposes. They have a new performance core x86 thing that's supposed to be, you know, wider, deeper, smarter. We can rebuild him, the $6 million, who knows how much, probably a lot more than that. And, you know, every single piece of it, you know, the front end where it reads the instructions and figures out what it's supposed to do, larger, smarter, wider, a fifth integer execution port added, you know, okay, so that's a 20% increase in number of integer execution ports, and, you know, floating point has been improved, memory has been improved, all of this stuff, and they try so hard in the Architecture Day, you know, hoo-ha, to make it seem like revolutionary, you know, new, incredible. And, you know, what do you get? You get a 19% improvement. You know, it's like, is that great? Well, I guess it's great, especially, you know, if you're talking about it's time to buy your next computer and you want to know, would you rather have 20% slower or would you rather have, you know, 20% better? But it doesn't really feel like, oh, wow, that's blowing the lid off the joint. This is how we're going to get, you know, dominance back, 19% improvement. They took the performance core and they put it in this bigger chip called the Alder Lake, whatever. And, you know, here it is. Those blue things there are the performance cores that we just saw. It says up to 16 cores. How do you get 16 cores out of that? Well, it's because you got those 8 dark blue ones, and then you've got those 4x4, 2 groups of 4 little light blue ones. Those are the efficient cores, which are also pretty powerful little computers, but they're so efficient that you can put 4 of them in the space that you put one of the performance cores. So 8 performance, 8 efficient, and there you go. And then a bunch of stuff packed around the outside. And that is the key to Intel's scaling philosophy. And so it repeats over and over during their Intel Architecture Day presentations. They take a handful. So here they're taking 8 of these little slices and then adding some more stuff on it that's shared amongst them. You know, in this case, it's more cache memory that helps speed things up. The problem is that you might have wanted to consider one of those little brown and gold things there to be one of the tile for our indefinitely scalability tile. But we can't, because now there's some unique stuff that's been put on it. So the tile is going to have to be something bigger that includes it. But then at the next level, it happens again. Now we have a bunch of slices being put together. This is for their graphics card. And then they add on some stuff that's shared. Ray tracing units and a bunch of other stuff. What is that? Pixel backends, rasterizers, and so forth, that's shared amongst them all. So once again, instead of having a sort of flat tiling, we have this hierarchical structure. There's a department, and then there's a department head, and then there's an organization over that that collects a bunch of departments, and we have a vice president, and so on. That is the Intel approach to scaling. And it's fine for what it is, but for indefinite scalability, it's a non-starter, right? Because those unique things, next level up, there are those things again. We saw them before. Now they added a whole bunch more cache that's shared amongst them, and so on. Now, you know, Intel is, you know, great at the, well, they do tons of really revolutionary hardware, you know, at the level of the hardware. Now what they've got is, so now when you're putting together multiple chips, they're using other chips, those little brown things, as interconnectors on the bottom of chips so that they can pack these things really close together. And that's you know, really good, because getting communication from one physical piece of silicon to another physical piece of silicon is really hard. And that's one of the things where, you know, the T2 tile does really terribly at inter-tile communications. They're working on it at the level of chips. They put those things together into the Sapphire Rapids, multiple tiles, single CPU, and that's the whole Intel philosophy of scaling in a nutshell. You put a bunch of them together and you put a boss on top. So at every stage, there's always a boss on top, and it just keeps going on up. There's a bunch with some extra stuff on it. Once again, the slices add something unique, this looks the same as we saw before, but this is their high performance computing stack of stuff, and now we have 2 of them. But once again, we stick in some 2 media engines that weren't present in the individual sets of slices, and so on. And so finally we get to Ponte Vecchio. This thing is a monster, 100 billion transistors. It's a whole bunch of different chips put together, including some chips that Intel didn't even make, and that is a, you know, revolutionary from the old Intel point of view. Compute tile, Rambo tile, base, HBM, EMIB tile, that one at the bottom. Those are those little things that connect the other tiles together. You put these together, make a bunch of them, and the first demo that they're doing is this Aurora blade. And Aurora is the name of the supercomputer that the Department of Energy has been trying to get built for, I don't know, at least a decade, I'm not sure. That it now is going to come into existence, supposedly, because of Ponte Vecchio being built into these boards with these, you know, cooling pipes all over the place to get them in so that they can be crammed in by the thousands to get this thing to get to an exascale computer. An exascale, whatever, is a billion billion. So you're supposed to get a billion billion floating point operations every second out of this thing. It's huge, but they have to hurry because other folks are now on the bridge, on the brink of bringing up their own in exascale machines designed in completely different ways. So the world keeps marching on, but that's where we end the story about Intel with the Aurora blade, Ponte Vecchio, and the Aurora system itself. Well, okay, so what does our indefinite scalability audit say for Intel using Ponte Vecchio for the Aurora system? Well, once again, step one is find the repeating tile, the thing that hasn't got any weird stuff that you can just stomp them down. But because of the Intel philosophy of adding something extra at each level, the tile for Aurora is the entire supercomputer. You'd have to plop down a whole nother supercomputer and so forth, and then they wouldn't even be able to talk to each other unless you did additional engineering. And that's the whole point of indefinite scalability. So Intel's score I'm giving it a 7. That is not, I'm not talking 7 meaning a C. That is a 7 out of 300, like that. And we'll explain a little bit more about how the indefinite scalability audit score works in a minute. But let's look at Tesla first. You know, Elon Musk, Pat Gelsinger was the smooth engineer. Elon Musk is the nerd engineer, and you know, I'm a little bit of both as far as it goes. And you know, Elon Musk is controversial, and you know, to some degree with good reason. You know, he's got sort of a serious case of cheese disease. Now, cheese disease we discovered when we were in grad school, and we would go to talks. You know, they would bring in researchers to give us talks, and we discovered that, you know, when it was a big name, when it was a big cheese coming to give us a talk, the talk often kind of stunk. People that were more unknown, that were earlier in their careers, would give fantastic talks, interesting, detailed, and so forth. And the big cheeses would just show up and, you know, talk from the top of their heads and have sloppy, all over the place talk, because they just sort of assumed everything that pearls of wisdom that would fall out of their mouths, that preparation was for lesser beings. Elon Musk has got a little bit of that, and you know, perhaps it's understandable. There aren't that many people who have been the, you know, richest human alive ever. But you know, it certainly can be aggravating, and you know, his butting into that whole cave situation with the stranded kids, that was just embarrassing. But nonetheless. From a nerd engineer point of view, I came across this other video, which I wanted to recommend to you. It's from a YouTube channel called Everyday Astronaut, and it's the Tim Dodd, he is the Everyday Astronaut, got a two and a half hour interview with Elon Musk wandering around the SpaceX facility, nerding out hardcore about rockets. Now, I don't really know very much about rockets. I learned a lot from listening to them go on, you know, but you sort of get bits and pieces from the outside and sort of marvel at the jargon, like I suspect, you know, some folks who come to the T2 tile projects, you know, they sort of don't, you know, get all the details either, but they can get the overall flow and the feel of it. And that's what I got from Everyday Astronaut. That's the logo. And here he is, you know, he's going on and on there. So that's Tim Dodd. That's the actual Everyday Astronaut who does this stuff. And, you know, he can totally kept up with Elon Musk. They were going back and forth about, you know, Russian full flow, hypergolic, you know, I don't even know what the jargon words are. And, you know, he even made some suggestions after Elon Musk had explained why they were doing some way. You know, Tim Dodd says, oh, I guess you can only do it this way because of blah, blah, blah. And that made Elon Musk think, maybe we actually could do it the other way. And, you know, he took the idea. It was really fun to watch. So they were wandering around, you know, looking at all this stuff. I mean, this huge stuff, these, you know, 3-ton grid fins that were about to get installed on the side of the rocket and so forth. And Tim Dodd was keeping up with everything, like I said, from Russian rockets to the Kerbal Space Program. And this is the reason that I wanted to stop and take another minute here. Elon Musk went through his rules of engineering, which I liked quite a bit, and you know, other people liked them too. You can find them all around the internet now. Number one, make the requirements less dumb. Number two, delete a part or process step. And his gloss on that is, if you're not adding stuff back in at least 10% of the time, then you're clearly not deleting enough stuff. And then only step three, which is where a lot of people begin, is to simplify and optimize. Step four is to accelerate the cycle time, whatever it takes to do it. And step five is actually try to automate the process. Now, of course, from a computer nerd point of view, typically we'll think, you know, we start with step five. You know, oh, I could write a script to do that. And so far, far, far away from saying, you know, do you really even need to do that task at all? This stuff strikes me as largely just right. And, you know, there's a bit of structure to it. You know, steps one and two are about problem setting. And steps three through five are about problem solving. And it's very common that people rush past the problem setting stage, the problem formulation, and they just take the obvious thing as read, as given, and want to run to the problem solving stage. But, you know, the mature thing to do, the smart thing to do, is to spend some time on problem setting. Can I not do this at all? Can I do it a different way? Can I skip a bunch of steps and so on? I do this right every once in a while. I do it wrong an awful lot. It's worth remembering. Elon Musk's stated goal is that everybody should be the chief systems engineer. And think how different that is from the Intel hierarchical philosophy, at least as reflected in their architecture. I'm not saying anything about their, human resources or how their org chart actually works. But just as expressed through the architecture, everybody as chief systems engineer is much more flat and empowering rather than, do your goal, report to your third level manager and so on. So I'm going to get me a everyday astronaut mug. It says they're recommended for use on Earth, so that's where I am. So Tim Dodd, thanks for what you do. That was I really enjoyed all those videos. Tesla AI Day, a lot of it was about self-driving cars and the vision stuff, the processing stuff, and I'm not going to talk about any of that. They also announced the Tesla bot with a really embarrassing person dressed in a white jumpsuit with a black head thing on, dancing around to sort of suggest it. The only thing that this reminded me... So there's the Tesla bot. Speed 5 miles an hour. It seems like the key idea with this Tesla bot is to make it a wuss. Make it friendly and not dangerous to humans. But I'm kind of dubious about this. If it works, it'll be really amazing. But it sort of means, so what happened to Boston Dynamics? How did they get into the wrong part of the search space so that they ended up producing these things? Because they made their things too strong. The little wussy bot is going to be better. I don't know. We shall see. It's going to be electrical rather than hydraulic. I'm not sure. But I'm going to probably side with my friend Rod Brooks, who responded to someone who was saying the Tesla bot is going to revolutionize the world in 10 days. We're going to think that this day was important because the Tesla bot, he says not. I think that's probably true, too. We'll see. I would like Elon Musk to succeed. He says he wants to make humans multiplanetary and take consciousness, light of consciousness to the stars. Those sound like great things to do. But at the same token, I agree with Bernie Sanders that we should have progressive taxes for this. Because one of the things about making money in the capitalist kind of system is that it does get easier to make money once you have money. So that's not linear. So to have a linear tax scheme on a non-linear process doesn't exactly make sense. We could make it all work out. I want to come down on both sides of this. The point is, it's Dojo. Dojo is a machine that they are building specifically for training neural nets. So it's not a general purpose machine, so it has an easier job than Intel does. They don't have to sell it into people who are saying, does it run Windows? Because all it's going to be doing is pumping data sets through as fast as possible to do stochastic gradient descent on machine learning networks, all different ways. So they got to have a blank slate, which Intel didn't really have, and that accounts for part of the difference, but I think it goes deeper than that. So here it is. It's a distributed compute architecture, compute elements plus network fabric. Look at that picture. Look at this picture. We'll put them side by side. The one at the top, that's the thing I made in 2008 as part of the media stuff to go with the T1 tile. We didn't call it that. It's the same idea. Yay. So this is the individual training node, the individual CPU core, in effect, of the Dojo architecture. It's got pretty good specs. It certainly puts the T2 tile CPUs to shame and so forth, both in terms of CPU power and in terms of connectivity. And then they start stacking them together. They put them, they're designed so that they butt edge to edge, and then you have 354 of them, and you make a ring of I/O around it, and you get the D1 chip, and that's their unit of fabrication. It's got 11 miles of wires in it. Each one is this big. And they're just beginning. Now you start, and there it is. So they've actually got some of those working. And then the plan is, right, so we're not actually there. We're moving into vaporware now, is to stack more and more and more of them until you get 500,000 of these things, each of which is a major deal. With 1,500 of these D1 chips, each of which has 354 of the individual cores on them. And you see it stretching out in, you know, to the left and right. Why is that? It's because they put conventional processors, communications, and host systems around the north and south and let it scale in the east and west. And that's critical for indefinite scalability, right? That means that we have just given up on scaling in the vertical direction. It looks like we could still scale in the horizontal direction. And this looks to me to be a system choice. I mean, I would imagine they could have made that thing keep going if they wanted to, but they needed to communicate to get data in and out from the outside world. So this is the choice they made. And, you know, here's the stack of the tiles. And, you know, power goes in the bottom, heat goes out in the top, the compute and communications moves back and forth along the middle. The power supply takes 18,000 amps for one of these things, and they have those actually exist too. And the idea is to put it together into a 10-cabinet group that's going to hold those 500,000 nodes in the 1,500, whatever it is, D1 chips put together into the training tiles. And, you know, 1.1 EFLOP, that's going to be another exascale machine. Now, it's custom for doing their machine learning stuff, but at the root, those are general purpose processors. They got a megabyte of RAM, you know. You could run the MFM on them, you know, with a little customization, a lot of customization, but you absolutely could, and then you'd get that incredible communication speed. So, the indefinite scalability for the Tesla Dojo Exapod system, I'm giving it a 91 out of 300. How do I get to 91? Well, if it was indefinitely scalable in one dimension, the score would be 100. If it was indefinitely scalable in two dimensions, which they didn't even try, the score would be 200, and so on. There's not much more so on to do there. I'm taking a couple of points off because we don't actually know how they're doing the addressing along that. We don't know if we can really extend out arbitrarily in that direction, and we don't know if they're actually giving each core a unique address for routing purposes, which I kind of suspect they may be doing. But anyway, it's very close to indefinitely scalable on one dimension. It could probably be made indefinitely scalable on one dimension. It might even be possible to make it indefinitely scalable on two dimensions. That's pretty exciting. So there's the bottom line. In the very first indefinite scalability audit, Intel versus Tesla head-to-head, Friday, August 19th, 2021, Tesla wins in a romp, 91-7. Exactly where does the T2 tile come in on the indefinite scalability audit? Well, it's going to be over 100. I don't know how close it is to 200. We'd have to figure it out sometime. So that was what I wanted to cover. On the insider's report, it's mostly bad news. I was supposed to have Ulam Code see a tile failed event. Didn't try it. Supposed to have the Ulam 5 building on the canonical farm. Didn't try it. So those are the goals. I'm just reposting them from next time. But I did do some stuff other than just look at videos and make slides. There's been a fundamental problem about how do you build up to higher scale in Ulam programming. And, you know, in particular, an atom in Ulam is only 71 bits in size. So how are you going to get bigger, an object bigger than that? Well, we know about that is you make molecules and we build a plate that has all this kind of stuff and so on. The problem is all of that is invisible to the programming layer. When you're programming atoms, if you want to deal with something that's bigger than 71 bits, you have to go over and look at the event window, next spot there, next spot there, and so forth. Couldn't we take a scheme, some semi-generalized scheme, to take pieces of multiple atoms and put them together into some virtual object? And in a way, when you think of actual chemistry, real chemistry, where molecular reactions occur, they go through, they describe it in terms of this activated complex, you know, where all the reactants have come together, but the actual reaction hasn't happened, and then the transition state where the reaction happens, and then, you know, the two, the hydrogens and the oxygen are gone, and now we have just one molecule of water. We've got the same kind of thing that I've now implemented here. I'm not going to do a demo. I just made some screenshots instead because I ran out of time, but we'll talk about it next time. we now have persistent transients. That sounds like a contradiction in terms. The whole point of a transient is it's a object, a structured kind of object in Ulam that's not limited to 71 bits. In fact, it can be a kilobit. No, actually, it can be 8 kilobits long. It can be really big. And the reason it can be really big is that it just lives on the execution stack. It's transient. It gets refreshed. It starts new every event. And then at the end of the event, it gets tossed away. But now we have a transient called persistent. How do we do it? We do it using this bit storage, a new idea that, So the key for persistent is it's got two virtual methods, gather and scatter. Gather is meant to look out in the event window and take whatever bits from here and a little bits from here, put them all together into the transient. You then go ahead and do your event on the transient where all the bits are now sitting in data members, very handy. And then afterwards, you scatter them back to wherever they came from. Or they could even go someplace different if we had a more advanced gather-scatter system, which, you know, is totally possible with this thing. It's built on top of bit storage. I'm not going to go through the details of it now. It'll be better next time when we'll have a demo. But I'm actually pretty excited about this. And I did a demo, so I've been working on the level 2 plate. This was all actually a sub-goal. This was some yak shaving off of the L2 plates. The problem with the L2 plates was to try to get that L2 plate sequencer in there to help control it. It meant I had to dedicate a whole extra row and a whole extra column in addition to the L1 plate that I was trying to surround, and it caused tremendous trouble and lots of asymmetries. And I was like, well, why couldn't I take several adjacent border sites, strap them together, and put the sequencer in there? And that's what led to the transient persistent L2 plate sequencer. It's a transient, and yet it persists. And so, all right, so here's a example where we've got a bunch of little my elements that have now been surrounded by L2 plate, nice and tight, just one level thick. And there's no way we're going to be able to see this, are we? No, we're not. One of the tricky businesses about these persistent transients is you can't click on them with the atom viewer because they're not in atoms. So here, these bits are actually changing in three different atoms every time an event happens on any one of them. So there's a certain amount of parallelism here, is that right now, you know, you get an event on either of these three guys, that's enough to do the gather, the event, and the scatter for all three of them. So you get better event efficiency out of this scheme as well. All right. Oh, I'm over a half an hour. I will stop. I hope the first indefinite scalability audit was interesting. I really do feel like the world is coming around to spatialized computing and tile-based computing. Now, again, tiles in general go back decades. The transputer, there's been a million of them. Thousands of them, maybe. But taking it seriously and doing the engineering work for it, that's very encouraging. Thanks, folks, for dropping in, whether you're here live or looking at it later. I really appreciate it. Hope to see you next time.